Hi everyone, and thank you for joining us in another episode of SE Interviews here at Cato Networks. And today we have Jack Dolan with us. Hi, Jack.
Hi, Al. How are you?
I'm great. It's a pleasure to have you with us. Before we get to the demo, I have a short introduction. Can you tell us, please, a little bit about what was your career path before you got to Cato and how you got to working for Cato?
Sure, I think most of my career was, about the WAN, starting with the Air Force back in the 80s. And then I went to a number of companies. I actually went to the very first SD-WAN company, I believe, called Route Times Technologies. And what we did was we picked which MPLS path, you know, MCI or WorldCom, when they were separate, which one was best at every given moment. And basically, we would switch the path in less than a second, you know, basically for full voice trunks. And that was in the early 2000s, and then went to Riverbed, went to Blue Coat, spent some time at Ariaka, and then came here really to become a sales guy, but I just like being an SE, so I went back to doing that. So thanks to Cato.
Great. So today you are an SC at Cato. What does that mean for you? What does the job include?
Yeah, it includes basically everything. The great thing about Cato is they're trying to do a lot, and therefore I get to learn a lot. What we provide is anywhere from DHCP to BGP to a lot of technology. And that's one of the great things is that Cato takes care of all of that for our customers. So it's very little that they have to do. They just basically have one portal. It's all there. And anything they need to configure, if they have to configure it or manage anything, is done from there. And of course, they've always got support to help them.
Great. And the countries or the states in the U.S. that you are covering are?
Yeah, my territory is the Southeast U.S., kind of covers from Southern Pennsylvania down to Miami over to Mississippi. So pretty big territory.
Cool. Yeah. So last thing before we move to the demo, what is the thing that you've been with us for several years? What is the thing that you love about Cato the most?
I love the fact that Shlomo Kramer has an amazing vision. he knew what this was going to become long before he started the company, I'm sure. But we can do anything. Cato can. It has the ability. The magic is in the cloud. The magic's in the pop. Basically, we can just about do anything we want to do. It's not limited to an appliance type thing. It's not in a box. You're not, restricted to only doing a few things or a couple things. So that's what I really like about it is the vision and where we could be and where we could go.
That's great. So. I couldn't agree more, honestly speaking. All right. So let's, let's see your demo. I'm going to let you share your screen now.
All right. So what I've got here is just a network map of what Cato would look like if we were on anyone's, enterprise network. And what we do is we basically connect from the edge. And this is what I'm going to focus on right here for the QoS discussion is just the edge. But basically we have a socket. Everything goes in a socket, including internet traffic. All right. We encrypt everything and we pick which path is best based on SD-WAN. So, which path is best based on the characteristics, latency, loss, and jitter of each link. And we take all of that traffic and we send it to the POP. And that's where it's unencrypted and sent out to the internet or sent to another location, such as a cloud service or a data center, or client, if the client is pulling information from that site, right? So there's, east-west traffic, and then there's north and south traffic. Okay, now remember, everything is encrypted, even if it's going to the internet, and therefore what we'll do is the POP, the closest POP, which is only 10 or 15 milliseconds away, not very far, will NAT out from the POP. Therefore, everything comes back. Now that's really important there because that means this outbound POP interface going towards the customer knows how much bandwidth the link has at the customer site. And therefore, we can control that bandwidth. Internet bandwidth as well, not just internal bandwidth going to any other place, especially voice over IP and things, other applications. But basically, we can control everything, coming back. So if you're going to have loss, all right, loss is going to happen usually because of congestion, usually because that last mile link right at the customer's edge is getting full. And inbound traffic was the toughest thing to manage. you know, we couldn't control that, especially stuff to and from the internet. Like if they had a box-to-box solution, like a lot of our competitors, they claim they have QoS, and they do inside the IPsec tunnel. But what about outside the tunnel? Outside the tunnel, you could have a large download from the internet, and the link, one of the two links, can get easily saturated, and then that causes congestion loss, which will actually bleed into the IPsec tunnels. And so that causes degradation of all traffic. It doesn't matter what QoS is set for, right? But in our case, we're taking all traffic and we're sending it out. Now, one thing that I just want to point on is that SD-WAN is a great technology. It's better than routing protocols. And what it does is it converges super fast. I mean, less than a second, sometimes a couple seconds at the most, but it's far, far better than routing protocols. But it's still a negative event, right? Think about that. Something has to happen. Something has to affect the traffic before it moves over. And that's, you know, that's what SD-WAN is. Ideally, what we want is not to have those SD-WAN events. Ideally, if we can control the bandwidth like we can with our QoS, there's less events, and therefore there's better stability and better quality overall. So I just want to make that point. So again, the POP is configured for how much bandwidth there is at the site, and therefore we can configure, you know, QoS for every single application. Okay, so I'm going to get into a live demo here about how that looks. And so this is a real customer. And what I've done was I've, basically changed the name. So, of course, they would definitely be a reference and don't mind me doing this. I did ask for permission. But we changed the name so it looks like a demo, but it's really a live customer. You can see all the sites that are connected. I can click on any site and take a look at, how their applications are split up down here, how much bandwidth they're doing overall, you know, so on and so forth. So nice page. But one of the things that I like about this is that I can jump to anywhere, analytics, security, so on and so forth. Now, I'm really going to be talking about QoS, which is under the networking. And what I like to do is I like to get my customers, I always suggest this, to create a queue, a QoS queue, for every single application that are important to them. Now, what does that mean? Well, Facebook can be important. You might allow Facebook, but you certainly don't want it to chew up all your bandwidth. You might allow Netflix, and you might allow other streaming media and stuff like that, but you don't want to allow it to, you know, use up all your bandwidth. You don't want to create a congestion event, okay? So control all your bandwidth. So what's nice is we have up to 254 queues, okay? Take advantage of that. I like to ask my customers to create a queue for every single application, and therefore we can monitor and control it all. Doesn't mean you have to create every single little application. It just means that what's important to you, let's control those, let's identify those. But also you're going to get a lot of visibility through this, and I'll show you that in a minute. So what we're doing here is these are the bandwidth management rules, or QoS rules, if you will. And notice that we've got WAN voice and video, internet voice and video, different applications down here for different things, different purposes. Printer traffic. Notice this is limited when the link gets congested. When a link gets congested, pull it down to 50% of the bandwidth. Okay, you need to print in order to invoice so that you can get paid. So it's a still high priority, you know, traffic. Therefore, it is in a high priority queue. At a 254, it's 21. External server traffic, all this other stuff. Outlook, really important, but if it gets congested, squash it down. You know, we want to control this. Don't let it get congested, right? When it starts to get congested, let's squash it. WAN SMB traffic. This is basically Windows file sharing between sites. Okay. You know, if it gets congested, limit it to 30%. There's a lot of that going on, so let's limit it. It still get there, but certainly we want to, you know, protect our bandwidth. As I go on down, the lesser the priority is, like internet traffic, all predefined internet traffic. If it's not listed up here, always limit 50%. We're giving internet traffic its own cap as if they had their own link still, right? But really what we're doing is we're saying, hey, you know, limit these guys. Now, this is my customer's rules. It's not mine. Okay, this is the way they want to do things. You guys can do anything that you'd like as well. Now, here's a good one. And I like demoing this a lot. Absolute values. Always limit 2 megabits per second. Some of their sites are like 50 megabits per second. Some are 200 megabits per second. This customer's policy, business policy is, hey, no more than 2 megabits per second. It's not just YouTube. You'll see in a second that it's all media streams. They found that most of the time these, you know, their users are using it for other reasons. So over here are the rules, and we're assigning them to the buckets. So the network rules are defined here. And I'm just going to go over what a network rule looks like. And this top one is one of our defaults. It's voice and video. Any application within voice and video. This is a category. And it doesn't matter whether it's WAN, okay, or going to the internet. So we can categorize traffic even if it stays in-house, okay? So this is from anywhere, anything, going to anywhere, anything, just to kind of show you what that looks like. Any from anywhere, groups, sites, hosts, VPN users, so on and so forth. So I can get very deep if I want to, discrete IPs, right? And so basically what this is doing is we've got, it's in priority 9, which is the highest priority. And remember, this one had no limits on the bandwidth and the bandwidth rules. Another thing to notice is that Cato will decide which path to choose, left or right, which ISP. And also we have the TCP acceleration and packet loss mitigation. Packet loss mitigation is essentially, hey, why not send every voice packet down both links or both paths? First one gets the other side wins, right? And if the first one is dropped or if it doesn't make it there, then you got the other one to make it there. So you got two chances, two different ISPs. The likelihood of both being down exactly at the same time is almost nil, right? So this is something that we feel better than MPLS for sure. I just want to show you down here, further down. This is where we show the Windows updates. This is another one. Windows updates, anybody, P50. I think that is limited to like 40% of the bandwidth, you know, under P50 rule. So down here, you can see here's the Windows updates. Here's that YouTube channel, or I should say YouTube rule. Again, P61, limited to 2 megabits per second. That's it. But you can see it's a bunch of things. And MediaStream, this category covers all of this. I don't know why he's got these four in here, but that's fine. I mean, but MediaStream kind of tries to catch everything anyway. Again, putting that into P61, which limits them to 2 megabits per second. Now remember, this bandwidth management here, okay, is global. So this is all global. Now you can go into the sites when you go to configuration and sites. You'll see the same thing, bandwidth management, and therefore per site you can change these values if you want to. Okay, so don't forget about that. So here's what I like. This is my favorite part. You go into analytics and sites. And the first thing that comes up at you is basically the different sites. You choose a site you want to take a look at. I like to look at Bell, which is their headquarters, as well as their, it's a data center as well. At first, you see all this, looks like loss. But the combination of the two, results in this. And this is what we're after. So this is true SD-WAN in action. There's a couple other things to point out too here. The left column is upstream. The right column is downstream. And you'll notice that on the links themselves, the dark link, dark blue and the light blue, dark is 30 megs up, and the light blue is 100 megs up. So we have to have a 3-to-10 ratio, which is kind of what you see here on the upstream. It's important to intelligently load balance. We don't want to just throw traffic to another link without knowing how big that link is. We could flood it. And then what happens? You got another event. You just come right back. You send traffic back and forth. And so you got to intelligently load balance. And the same thing with the downstream. The downstream, the blue is much larger. Dark blue is much larger. The light blue is only one third. So it's got to have that 3-to-1 ratio here. And that's exactly what we'll see over here as well. So that's the first thing as far as, make sure that we're load balancing first before we apply QoS stuff. Okay. Notice that this stuff says there's a lot of a lot of loss here. And really there's very, very little. You can see the loss right here in both upstream and downstream. So that's why we're, doing very, very well up here. So you can see that. Then you have the jitter, and then you have the latency. Now notice the dark blue is like 35, 40 milliseconds, but that's still good for a lot of traffic. Okay, and then this is only 10 or 11, 12 milliseconds, and it's pretty flat. This is your DIA, this is your broadband, and their performance is doing excellent. Well, how do we know performance is doing excellent? Over here, you go to Priority Analyzer, and this is where you're looking at your QoS rules that you set up. And if it's green, it's good. So no longer as app, you know, as network engineers, do we have to tell our boss, well, the network looks pretty good. Latency loss jitter looks good. Now we can say, well, every application seems to be doing really well. If it's green, it's good. Great means there's nothing there. They didn't use it at that site. That's okay. If it's red or yellow, it demands attention. And as we come down here, we're looking at all the applications here. And look at that. There's their YouTube. See, it's yellow. But that's because we're discarding traffic, as you can see here. Not 1.9% that we're actually discarding packets because they're trying to go over that 2 megabits per second. Now, I can look at it this way if I want to. I can actually open this up. You know, here's WinRDP and see who is doing what. Okay, I can see all these people doing terminal server and TS broker traffic. It's all part of the same, you know, two different rule sets, right? I'm sorry, the same rule set, and then the IP addresses. Now, if they were tied into Active Directory, which we can do, you get a username here instead of the IP addresses, which is also extremely helpful. And you, by the way, you can apply, you know, Active Directory names and groups to, you know, firewall rules, network rules here. So it makes it easy for you to create things, sort of like you know, the finance group can go to the AWS finance server, but no one else can even ping it. That's pretty powerful. Okay. So again, what I like about this is not only do I get some visibility into per application, but I can also go to real time. Again, the default is, hey, what does the network look like? What do the WAN links look like? And so we can show that right here as we're seeing traffic live coming across here. I can see how much traffic we're doing on a per link basis. I can also look at what are the top 10, you know, hosts as well as the top 10 applications. These guys do a ton of voice. And so we see a lot of UDP, and then you see other applications here. Now, every one of these, Skype and Teams, we already have one here. RDP is part of the voice. You know, search and miscellaneous apps, that could be its own queue if we wanted to. LDAP. Might be enough traffic there that we might want that to be its own queue. So again, create a queue if you want to for whatever is important. So, you know, it gives you at least visibility. You can break it apart. You can see how much traffic there is per app if you want to. But what I like is this. We create these queues. Why not get even deeper real-time visibility? And that's exactly, what we're seeing here. And so, as you go down, you know, the high priority stuff, we should never, ever have any packet loss up here, unless it's randomly created, right? Let's say a router port goes down, but that's pretty rare. I mean, and that should be fixed, you know, fairly quickly. The next thing, though, is we come down here to YouTube, and we actually see 2% loss, and that's us discarding the traffic, right? Because this guy tried to go above 2 megs, or these guys. And again, I can look them up, who's doing this right now. And again, I could see it by name if they were connected to AD. All right, so really important. I think this is one of the coolest features Cato has because, you know, you get full visibility. It's only the traffic that you care about, not a bunch of pre-canned junk stuff. You can add, delete anytime you want to. Here's, you know, you get great visibility and when you're actually discarding. You know, this is the discards for that YouTube traffic there. You know, you can see how much bandwidth up and down. It's just a really cool interface to be able to watch everything live. So, and then control. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jack. That was a great demo. And thank you very much for joining us today for SE interviews here at Cato Networks. Thank you.
Thank you.